Hi everyone, welcome to the meetup. I'm Martin Goodson. I'm from Evolution AI, the sponsors of the meetup. We're organizing it together with Giuseppe Papello, my colleague also from Evolution AI. And today as speaker, we have Christian Szegedy, who's from Google Research, who will speak for about 40 minutes on the inverse mindset of machine learning. And then we will have a QA for about 20 minutes, which will be facilitated by Max Jadeberg, who's a researcher at DeepMind. As usual, if you can put your questions into the QA function of Zoom, that would be great. Don't use the chat unless you want to particularly communicate with the organizers. So keep to the QA functionality. And as usual, if you put your hand up, we will, you're much more likely to have your question answered. And also we will unmute you so you can answer your question. You can ask your question yourself. So thanks for all of that. I'm gonna hand over to Christian.
Thanks. Yeah, Christian. Thanks for that, Martin. So, so I will talk a bit about some, so basically that's a point of view to machine learning. So, and I will give several examples. So I will start with a few examples that I think most of you probably know. And then at the second half of the presentation, I try to give examples that are less obvious and more exciting. But so what is this whole thing is about? So it's basically what I'm trying to contrast two things. One thing is the engineering mindset, the forward mindset, that let's say you want to optimize some objective or train a model, then you could say, okay, I designed the best algorithm for the purpose. I take the best neural network architecture that's there, or even modify the neural network in a certain way that it fits my problem. And that is actually, it's a large part of the literature. So especially before, let's say 2015, people were mostly doing like super complicated systems that coped with the particular modality of the data. But here with the neural networks, it changes a lot, because nowadays we tend to do more and more inverse ideas. And in the inverse idea is that we don't necessarily try to create a good architecture. We just take an off-the-shelf architecture and then we train it for some auxiliary objective function, something that is just tangentially related to the task we want to solve. And then we just use that model as a more expert model for that purpose. So what do I mean by that? Is, for example, imagine that you want to do sentiment analysis, meaning that you want to decide whether, let's say, a movie review is a positive or a negative review. So you could try to train it on user ratings. So for example, take the input as a user review, and then you output how many stars the user gave. And then you can look at, okay, what neural network could help me, and try to engineer neural networks that are good for this task. But I mean, nowadays, nobody does that. It's really, what we are doing is that we pick a task that is very relevant for this task, namely language understanding, and then take trained models for language understanding first, or language modeling. So what does it mean? So could you put in the missing words into this sentence? So that is the task in the BERT model that you, so BERT is basically a transformer, but it's trained on such tasks. So the idea is that understanding the language means that you can figure out missing words in a text. So, I mean, if you probably could have guessed it to some extent what was missing, but it's not trivial. So, and it, the task has to be not quite trivial, but shouldn't be too hard. So it should be learnable. So basically what BERT is doing is you take an original sentence, mask out some words, and then train a neural network to predict the missing words. And it's particularly used for transformers, and we will talk a bit later why transformer is a good idea in this case. But in general, it could be done with any model. It could be done with WaveNet, it could be done with LSTM, it could be done with any other neural network sequence model that processes sequences. But transformers are somehow much better for learning these kind of biases that is necessary for the Down syndrome task. So, and then when we want to solve, let's say, the sentiment classification or sentiment analysis problem, then we just fine tune it with the supervised data. So what are the advantages of this approach? Yeah. So it's like, of course, the big advantage is that this training doesn't require any labeled data. And you can train it on almost anything. And also, you can use a pre-trained model many times for different tasks as well. So you can, and it's probably trains much faster for the downstream task if it's pre-trained. But the whole idea in this case is basically it's a denoising autoencoder. So you take a data source, you corrupt it, and then let the neural network reconstruct the original. And a lot of pre-training or self-supervised training is based on this, the same idea, like variations of this idea. Even sometimes it's not that obvious that it is this idea, but almost always this idea is in the background. And this is a very cool idea because it's basically, it's super applicable in a lot of contexts. So you can just like, gives you a frame of reference of what you want to do. And then you can design tasks for it. And you don't need to have so much expertise on neural network architecture design or even mathematics. You just have to have some intuition of what is a useful task to solve. And it's much easier to do than something like really technical. So it's basically what we are becoming slowly is that we becoming teachers to neural networks. But this is not always obvious that what is this task. So for example, if you look at next token prediction, it's called generative pre-training in some circles, or GPT is an example of that, it's also based on the same idea. So basically you say, okay, I'm asking out the next word, for every span in the sequence, and then say, okay, please give me the next word, but utilizing only the words before it. So it's very similar task. But if you train on this task, you get like similar quality model, you get the similar advantages. And in addition to that, you also get the generative model. So you can even use this model to sample words. So, but in a sense, it's very similar because you are just saying, I'm asking out the present word and the next or the later words. So, and this idea is actually very old. I mean, it's from the 90s, and it was first done with LSTMs. And Schmidt-Tuber and Hochreiter. So that's a classic paper. So, but nowadays it gained an popularity a lot because of a lot of very high quality language models being around. And like, for example, OpenAI's GPT is accessible and it trained on a lot of data and it's a very large model, the later generations. But it's not just applicable to language. It can be applied to even image generation. And actually most people are not really aware, but this like pixel RNN and pixel CNN used to be like the state of the art for image generation, so better than GANs. And it's the exact same idea. You are just masking out all the present and future pixels and you try to predict the next pixel in a certain ordering. So you have like variations with different architectures, RNNs or CNNs, and even with transformers. So that's a recent OpenAI paper where they generated images with transformers. So these are called autoregressive models, and it also not just can be used for sampling and generating data, but it also computes a log likelihood of the data. So you are just looking at all the log it, sum them up, and you get a likelihood of that sentence. So it can be even used as an outlier detector, but it has a big problem, so it's hard to parallelize. So if you want to generate images with this approach, you need a lot of compute. It generates very high quality outputs, but it's much more expensive to run than a convolutional network, like in GAN. So that's, what is it? Is it there? Yeah. So this goes to the, okay, so how can we do like fast image generation? So this is something you probably already know. So it's a classical autoencoder, but the problem here is that first of all, add to distance is not a great metric. And secondly, if you want to just randomly generate images, not all latent code would necessarily correspond to an image. So here the idea is that you take an original image, encode it as a code, and then you decode it. And then you can sample from the latent code, which is a compressed representation of the image. This doesn't work. So one has to fix at least the latent code problem. And that's how like the variational autoencoders came about. So if you do stochastic generation and regularization for the latent code, then you get basically VAEs. So that's most people probably know it. And of course, this is a classic, the GAN, is that you completely remove the encoder and they just say, okay, I'm just generating random latents and generate images. And then another network decides what is a natural image and what is a generated image. And then you backpropagate through this whole chain. But if you look at it, then it's also, this is also just basically a new task. So it's basically, it fits in this inverse mindset that you don't really care what is this encoder neural network or the discriminator. Maybe you care a bit about the loss function because with certain loss functions, it doesn't work that well. But in general, it's the construction is about creating a good task that is useful for you. And then once the task is done, you are done. So that's the beauty of this inverse mindset business. So if you look at this event mindset, it can be done much more with it. So for example, okay, how do you formulate like translation? So how can you do translations without supervision? And this is a very cool idea that you just translate back and forth. And then you ask the network, please make the chaining of the true translations to be identity. And you want the translated image to look natural at the same time. So this is cycle GAN. But this is also, again, it's just a cool task. You just pose it to the network. You don't care what are those models in the middle. You just created a cool task for the network, and then it learns to translate automatically between different styles or modalities even. So, of course, you need a pretty good match between the two kind of modalities. But if you have like data that is that you have like similar data set, but without any pairing, so you cannot supervise the translation. You can even translate between natural languages, which is an amazing thing. And I'm also a bit surprised by how well it actually works. So this is, again, it's an example of just like creating the right task is the most important thing. Your network architecture or the math behind it is basically not that important. It's basically creativity that is necessary just to figure out the right task to create for the to be solved. So this is another. So let's get into terrains now that are less known. I'm not sure that this how well known is this. I really like this. So it's again a kind of like a self-supervised training, but the extra idea is that you don't just learn to do like predict the mass tokens like in BERT, but you also try to retrieve a document that is most helpful for predicting the mass curve. So you are both training a system for retrieving from a large set of documents, and you can self-supervise it by saying, okay, I'm retrieving more document than I need, and then see which one is the most useful for answering my question. And then you say, okay, if something was useful, then that's the document I should have retrieved. So you are training your retrieval at the same time as you are training your language model, and then it learns to retrieve better and better documents as it goes. So it's really nifty, and I think this is a very general paradigm, and it could be used for a lot of other purposes. So I think this is just starting to become very popular. I mean, in certain circles, but still not as widely known as GAN, for example, or GPT. But I think it's a very nice idea. It demonstrates how creating new interesting tasks is a key in machine learning with neural networks. So let me go to some problems that I have been working on. So I'm mostly working on mathematical reasoning with neural networks, and so basically creating systems that can do reasoning and associate natural language with mathematical content. So I will show a few examples of this inverse mindset in that case. So it's like if you look at it, then the models we are using are not really any different from what most people use in natural language. So everybody uses transformers nowadays. And so BERT, GPT, MAS, T5, all of them are basically transformers. Some of them use like different attention mechanisms that are optimized, but in general, they use the same architecture or very similar. So mostly the task is that they formulate the task a bit differently. So let's get back. So BERT is the you are predicting MAS tokens. GPT, you are predicting next token, and in T5, you can predict even a subsequence. So basically, you're masking out the whole subsequence, and then you're predicting the whole subsequence. So how could we use that for formal data? So for example, imagine that we want to do some mathematical reasoning, and then we start generating like subsequence tasks. For example, you can mask out the B or you from this expression, or you can mask out in the second sentence, and it's really hard to tell what is correct or not. So it's the subsequences in natural language typically correspond to something a meaningful unit in the text. But in formal data, like formal mathematics or programming languages, you cannot really do that. So what we talk about here is also applicable to programming languages just as well. So here the idea is that we don't just skip a sequence, but we say we only mask out certain subtrees from the expression. So that makes the task much easier, but it's also more well defined. So the network has less uncertainty to deal with. And we can measure. The good thing about this task is that a lot of problems, I will show a few problems, are subs basically immediately can be formulated as this problem. So here again, the task is you get some mathematical formula in some certain, like we're using an S expression here for simplicity. And then we mask out this part of basically that's a type declaration in the formula. And then we ask the network to encode the formula with the whole. And then we want to generate the missing part. And the missing part is generated autoregressively, just as I before, like when we're always predicting the next token based on the previous tokens. So this is basically the whole idea. The idea is this is nothing really fancy. The whole encoder, decoder, it's an existing infrastructure. So it's basically used for machine translation. We're just using it on different input. That's it. So, and then the really cool thing about this task that, for example, you can do type inference with it. And you can measure, for example, the performance of type inference. So how do we do type inference? We just say mask out the types. Or just one type, or we can mask out all the types in a programming language, and I say, please predict me, predict all the types that we are missing. And interestingly, with the skip tree training, if we do we get very high accuracy on the type prediction. So for example, it's this percentages refer to those cases where the whole type is correct. So it's not just like token level accuracy. And also we get also over 90% accuracy, even if we don't predict a single type, but we have to predict all the missing types. So basically we're deleting all the types and then asking to predict one of the missing types. But we can try to predict anything. So for example, in this case, please predict what is the assumption that is needed for this formula to hold. So when is x1 over y1 equals x2 over y2? And when is that equivalent to x1 times y2 equals x2 times y1? So it typically holds, but I mean, there's still, you have to make some assumptions. It doesn't hold all the time. Why doesn't it hold? It doesn't hold because if you cannot divide by zero. And then in such cases, so the neural network is correctly can predict that you have to put in y1 doesn't equal zero and y2 doesn't equal zero. So it has to predict this whole statement. Or it can complete equality. So you say that x to the n minus 1 equals, and then it can predict that it's a sum of all the powers. So basically it's a geometric series, but yeah, so the neuron, and we are training on a lot of formulas, and interestingly the neural networks learns to do solve a lot of these tasks with relatively high accuracy. And the whole training is completely unsupervised because you are just taking a lot of formulas from existing proofs, and then you just keep certain parts of those trees. It also can be used for conjecturing. So this is a cool task because you can pre-train on this task, and it's immediately useful. So and it can predict even, it can create even new conjectures that are true and non-trivial. But I mean, it's mostly not that. So it doesn't predict super interesting conjectures, but it still predicts useful ones quite a few times. So yeah. So, but yeah, our goal is still to improve reasoning capabilities. So one could say, okay, let's pre-train on this skip tree task. But reasoning capabilities, so, and we can do that and expect some gains. But for example, in theorem proving benchmarks, but we can do better. So this is a very, this task is very hard to train. So I mean, it's like it takes a long time to train a transformer to solve this task. It's like million steps and a lot of data. But let's say if we don't even have any data, right? Can we just create a neural network that can do certain logical reasoning steps? So for example, predicting the missing proof step from a proof, complicated mathematical proof. And then the idea is, here is again, we creating a task. So what task can we create? And let's assume we don't even have any data. So can we create something? And here the idea is that we can synthesize data such that it enhances the capabilities of the neural network on a real deduction task. And that data doesn't even have to do anything with the syntax of the language that we are targeting. So in order to address what kind of data we generate, we took these reasoning primitives as a hint or as a motivation. And so basically there are three kinds of mathematical reasoning. Deduction is when you have a rule and a case, and then you want to predict the result. So most people think that this is reasoning. I mean, most mathematicians doesn't really do too much deductions. When you do mathematics, typically do induction, actually. So most like coming up with conjectures. But there is also abduction when you predict the case from the rule and the result, so the starting point. And then the induction is when you try to figure out what is the rule. And that's actually very important. And actually induction is the problem that most previous like existing automated reasoning systems that are not based on learning are not doing very well. So induction is a long-standing problem in automated reasoning. So to do well on it, and it hasn't been made very much progress before. So it's before the machine learning started to enter the field. So okay, so these are primitive. So how do we make the network learn this kind of reasoning? The idea is that we generate some very simple synthetic tasks for each of them, and those synthetic tasks are that we list all the symbols that are in the so we generate such a situation with random rules and random symbols, and then we list all the symbols that that occur in the formula. And then we say, okay, please, and we know what is the target because we created the whole thing synthetically. And then we let the neural network to output the case in this case, so the starting point, so from which the whole deduction was started. And then, we generate actually much longer examples, so these are it is a very small one, so we generate much more complicated ones, but actually you can generate a lot of synthetic data with 100 lines of Python code. And this is not that this is doesn't even it doesn't assumes any syntax, so we don't even assume that the operators have some precedences or anything. They are just like abstract symbols. We just wrote it in a way that it's useful for the people to understand. And then we pre-train a transformer model on just these kind of inputs and outputs. And the interesting thing, what comes out of it, so you can test it on next proof test prediction task. For example, there is a data set on Isabel, which is an automated theorem prover that has several hundred thousands of proof steps. And then you can say, okay, what is the, please predict the next proof step in this proof. So that's a very, very highly non-trivial task. If you can solve that task, then you basically have like a very good, like a symbolic reasoning engine. And then the really interesting thing is that this is, so this top one accuracy and top 10 accuracy is that if the whole proof step is correct, and the top 10 means that the ground truth proof step is in the top 10 predicted proof steps. And as you can see, if you pre-train on various synthetic reasoning tasks, then you get some improvements. And interestingly, the abduction is better than if you pre-train it on all of them somehow, at least for the top 10 accuracy. But we have other results where actually the other ones help. So not all synthetic tasks help. And the really interesting thing about this is that you don't need to pre-train a long time. So the network can learn this task very easily so it levels off very quickly. So it only needs like 20,000 steps to reach its maximum performance. But then it even improves on skip tree, which is a much, much harder task that I just showed. So basically, this retraining task, synthetic task, is very helpful for, so very fast, it hardly adds any to the training because the skip tree trains for a million steps and you only needed 10,000 steps for pre-training. So it's not really a traditional pre-training approach where you are pre-training most of the time and then the downstream task is very cheap. The pre-training is cheap and the downstream task is very expensive. So I'm close to finishing, but let me ask, so does it matter that we use transformer or is it working with LSTMs? And the interesting observation is that it This pre-training helps a bit with LSTMs, but it helps much more with transformers. And our hypothesis is that it basically the transformers have this internal wiring capability that it learns how to wire itself based on the data. And then the LSTM doesn't have, at least it cannot train it that well. So basically the transformer is a self-routing neural network architecture. So our hypothesis is that it learns some inductive biases for this reasoning task, and that helps the, so that's a very generic inductive bias, not just some like specific to the particular task, because our syntax was completely disjoint from the final task. And actually we also tested that if we remove the embeddings of the first layer, so the symbols embedding, then it's still the same quality remains. So there was no dropping quality. So it doesn't even it doesn't learn any lexicographic knowledge. It learns some algorithmic knowledge. We don't know how. And even if we wanted to create a neural network that just does better on this abduction or deduction task, we couldn't. So I mean, I don't know how to do that. It would be a very hard problem to architect an architecture that has the right biases for that. But I think that transformer opens a way to generate much more synthetic tasks now, and we can expect a lot of those biases we can imbue into the network, and then have the opportunity to improve our network architecture or quality significantly just by creating the right sequence of synthetic tasks. And I think this paper is one of the first in this direction, but I think this will be a big direction in this decade of machine learning. So this concludes my talk, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, Christian. Fantastic talk. I'm now going to introduce Max Jenneberg, who will be facilitating the discussion. And as ever, please do put your questions in the audience into the QA function, and we'll read them out. And if you put your hand up, then we'll also ask you to ask your own question. So handing over to Max now.
All right, cool. Thank you, Christian. It was a really interesting talk. It made me think about this paper. I don't know if you touched on it, but the universal computation engines, transformers, is yeah. Universal computation engines. It feels like there's a connection there with what you're talking about.
Yeah, that's a very good point. So yes, I think that so transformers have this kind of very generic architecture that is even like permutation equivariant, and is very like basically the good thing about transformers is that they are super flexible, so you can increase your attention window even if you trained on a shorter window. So basically it can learn to do any computation, which is not very surprising. I mean, it was expected, but the paper shows that it's so in detail that is correct. And I think that's important. So basically if you don't have that capability, then you cannot expect the network to easily learn in algorithmic biases that are useful for your task. So, actually, I think even LSTM is a universal computing engine. So it's like it's just harder to train. I'm not 100% sure, but I mean 99% sure.
That's great. Just maybe quickly before we field some questions, do you have any intuition? You know, you've worked a lot with lots of different architectures over the years. Do you have any intuition or like, you know, architectural biases that you really wish would work? Well, that you really think should work, but you know, you haven't seen working yet. Along the lines of, you know, the self-attention of transformers, something as general as that.
Yeah, I'm happy that actually transformers work so well without any extra engineering. I tried several like combinations by combining with with LSTMs, or combining with ConvNets. So basically you can say, okay, you don't just use one by one convolutions in your transformer. If you have a sequence task, you could have like 3x3 or whatever. And then actually what turns out, what happens is typically that you that the model trains much faster in the beginning, but then it converges to a lower plateau. So somehow the fact that the model has to learn and it has to exploit that flexibility that the transformer provides is somehow in the final result it's still better somehow. And I think it's a very cool thing because it shows how generic and how so basically you don't put too much you don't put too much restriction on the network and still works. So that's really great.
Yeah. And going back to this idea of, you know, the inverse problem, right? And rather than the forward task and the inverse task, can we just think about, you know, keep creating these generators of data and just keep adding them into the mix and keep filling up our transformers with more and more mixes of, you know, you said it takes 100 lines of Python code for this abduction task, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
This is low complexity, right? Is this a scalable path to getting like better and better, you know, universal computation transformers? We can just keep adding in these human interesting tasks.
Yeah, I think that's a very good direction. I think it will be researched very soon. I'm quite certain. So yeah, I mean it's basically like architecture engineering, but so architecture exploration, but instead you say task exploration. Mm. So, but if you know that the tasks improve the models and they can be trained relatively fast. So for example, this synthetic task that I presented, this trains very fast. You need a few hours. I mean, 15 minutes or something. And a few GPUs, then you can explore a lot of these tasks and then the combinations, and you could generate programs that generate tasks for you. And so I think that's a really cool direction. And I'm looking forward to seeing it.
Because I was thinking about sort of, you know, even go maybe like 4 or 5 years ago, a lot of focus in the community was how can you take some, you know, human bias or some bias that you know and create a differentiable, you know, architectural piece to slot into your architecture. And now this is flipping its head, and it said instead it's too hard to create these differentiable pieces. Instead we have these universal architectures like transformer, and we forget about the complexity of making things differentiable. We push it on the data creation side.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. I think that's the future. I think that we need something to make transformers a bit better. I mean, for example, larger memory, for example, and things like that. But I think we are pretty close to the point where I think it's like task creation will be the next frontier. And I think we are just entering that era.
Interesting. Maybe on that note, we have one question I can see in the Q&A. On Big Bird and optimizing quadratic memory requirements by earlier models like BERT by increasing input sequence length and employing random attention. I guess in relation to sparse models, random attention models would also be effective. What are your views on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think you need certain ideas to make the transformer scalable. They typically don't change too much what how it works or what it does. But and typically the vanilla transformer is the highest quality, but of course the slowest for long sequences or long inputs. And I mean I think it's a very important line of research because you want to have efficient transformers. But yeah, I typically they don't improve the quality. They do improve the running time for long inputs, which is very important. But I think that there are other ways to improve the running time as well. So that's also an interesting direction on how to make it work so that it still retains most of the transformer advantages. But that is it's a super popular research domain. Like the past two years, like it's like so many papers came out with various ways of improving the quadratic time. What I'm more skeptical about is, for example, this newer ideas with the Fourier transformation. And I think it doesn't really show a convincing a direction. So I believe that that you still need at least some multiplicative action. So that's something important in the transformer, that it can multiplicatively do some kind of gating. But there are also really cool new papers that don't do any attention, but do like more like gating. And I think that's likely to be, I could imagine that it will overtake transformers. Yeah. It's hard to tell at this point, yeah. But I really like the transformer, because the transformer has also this permutation. So it's much easier to represent sets with it. So most of the work that is like trying to make transformers much more efficient assume a sequence or an image. And I think that's a good thing that we don't have to assume that.
Yeah. Cool. All right. I think we've got a question from the audience from Talib. Rao, you had your hand up, I think. Did you want to ask your question yourself?
Sure. Hey, nice talk, Christian. I'm just going to read out what I wrote. What intuitions do we have on the kinds of inductive biases each of these tasks create? Also, do you have any meta guidelines for engineering new tasks?
Yeah, I mean, we wanted to look into what happens. So what happens inside the network? So why does it really help solving anything new? But it's really hard to analyze. So we stopped doing it because we couldn't figure out anything. So it's a big black box. So that's a bit of a problem with all these like synthetic or engineer tasks, is that very hard to understand what's going on inside the network. And okay, so what was the other question? So what do I think, what kind of tasks, so how should we generate tasks?
What are some guidelines you would have for engineering new tasks, especially if there is no sort of like admissible heuristic that will tell us that, you know, having this particular set of self-supervised tasks will help a certain other downstream adaptation?
Yeah, so I mean, these are guesses, what I tell, because I mean, we have only one example for where we did this at all. So I don't have too many measurement points to generalize from. But so my personal intuition that might be wrong is that you want to generate very simple tasks, so much simpler than at least in the beginning when your network is not that good. So you basically, what we try to do is to analyze what is the absolute, like if you would write a program, what would be the absolute minimal subroutines that you expect to be able to perform, and not necessarily subroutines that you would really want to use, but something that at least does something equivalent. So for example, this abduction task is basically, some of them is basically just like looking up something in a dictionary, something. So I think, and also it has to be able to rewrite to some extent. So basically say, okay, I want to rearrange certain symbols so that it according to other symbols. And I think it's important that these tasks, they don't have to be exactly the same task that you will be using or use as subroutines, but I mean, in general, what is the simplest thing that you want the network to have a capability to do and is related to your final task? And that doesn't have to be very closely related, though.
If I may follow up on that, do you think that task engineering is kind of like feature engineering in new clothes. Or if you disagree with that, can you explain how the two would differ?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I like task engineering better than feature engineering, but I agree to some extent that it's very similar in that you are creating some, trying to create something that helps your network or informs it artificially. And that's a kind of ugly. I agree with that assessment. But I mean, that you can make the same statement about architecture engineering, which is also ugly. I mean,
sure.
It's slightly less ugly than architecture engineering or feature engineering. So to me, it's like, I think that feature engineering is the most ugly because, first of all, it's very strict and it really constrains your network. And then architecture engineering is a bit more mellow because it doesn't force your network to exactly do something in a certain way. And then task engineering is even more soft because you just say, okay, please do, just make sure that you can do at least this as well. And then you hope that it will help with the other tasks. So to me, it's like, I feel much more positive about task engineering than the other two.
Thanks, Christian.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you. I think we have a hand up from Martin.
We do, but we don't have a question. So, Martins, could you add your question? Can everyone just add your question to the QA before you put your hand up? So we'll just go through the QA first.
Cool. Okay, so going through the Q&A. So from Samir, we have a question. It can seem as though the application of transformers has overtaken our understanding to some extent. Where are you seeing interesting work in explaining or extracting what is it the transformers have actually learned?
Yeah, as mentioned, I mean, I looked a bit into it. I mean, not very hard. And I have to admit, most people have no idea. I mean, we can visualize like attention patterns, but it's very messy. You can understand to some extent, for example, in natural languages, what are those attention patterns. But they are often very counterintuitive. So I don't really know. I mean, there is no such a work like for ConvNet. People started to the circuit project by Christopher Ola. That's very interesting for ConvNet, but I don't know of anything to that extent for transformers. But I think transformers can learn much more algorithmic things. So it will be much harder reverse engineer of what is the real algorithm in a transformer than in a ConvNet, where it's mostly just pattern matching. So I think it will be very hard. Maybe we can create some, like we could learn something to help us, but I don't really know how.
I guess sort of a follow-up question is, yeah, for some applications we might need this, isn't it? And do you think we need this and for applications? And especially thinking about these like formal, this sort of formal language data, if we're not getting 100% accuracy, can these models be used in applications? Especially if we don't know how they work. What are your views on that?
Yeah, I don't find it troubling at all because so for example, my project where we do mostly like formal reasoning, we have actually a verification engine. So you typically you have a way to verify things. So that's one of the reasons that is good. It's a good idea to work with formal systems because I mean you can still use the neural network, but they don't. So they don't have to be precise. So let's say you, I didn't manage to prove the statement, I will try proving it again. Or it might be that I did the wrong type inference, I can check the type correctness still, because checking type correctness is easier than inference. And so I think the key is that you generate output that can be verified. You don't have to understand how it came about. And the same thing is in chess and Go, actually, because in chess, like, the verification is that you win the game, right? So you don't really need to give a proof that this is the optimal move.
Yeah, it's very powerful with these non-perfect neural network outputs. If you then have that as just like the seed of some search process or verification processes. It's really powerful.
I don't say it's a seed. I mean, for example, in our system, we're doing mostly almost everything with neural networks, but we have still the final check. And that's consume much less time. But I don't think it's necessary. I mean, you really want to solve problems that... So actually, neural networks are really good at producing formal artifacts. I was really super surprised. So, for example, one of my colleagues had a paper recently with some German university where they took a logic formula and they generated actual traces with a transformer that shows that, okay, that satisfies the formula. So they didn't even do any search. They are just like as an input-output translation task, and it worked very well. And similar results are, for example, when you try to do proofs. So people just output the proof, the whole proof at once, and then it often works. So it's really surprising how good transformers are on these symbolic tasks.
All right, let's think about the future of transformers. Martins, do you want to ask your question now?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, Christian. Thanks for the talk. Very some very interesting avenues there. I think my question is in some sense is quite basic or generic. I've been working quite a bit with GPT-2 in recent months, and I'm always amazed how it manages to generate kind of interesting and creative language. But at the same time, I'm equally amazed when I see examples of GPT-3 even getting questions and then make weird assumptions. Like it clearly doesn't really understand what you're asking. It has some sort of creative way of understanding it, if I can put it that way. And I find it frustrating because I want to sort of guide it in. I guess generating very specific types of content almost in a kind of question and answer. So my question is simply, based on the research that you've been doing, that you've been seeing, how far away do you think is a kind of pre-trained model that, you know, maybe accessible to the general public, something like GPT, that would be better at accurate comprehension questions?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, concretely, I mean, I only know Google internal models, and some of them get published, but I don't really think that they are any better in that sense than GPT-3, 2 or 3. So I think there is a fundamental problem with how GPT is trained. Because what I really think, and all those models, I think it's everything is basically trained for faking things. So I think it's a wrong objective function. So that's why I'm working with mathematics, because that I can train on real stuff that actually really doing reasoning, and then I can check that things actually make sense. And I think you can train things or real stuff, but it's so. For example, one idea that I would have to train these systems is that you should have multiple transformers that communicate with each other in natural language. So I think that would basically for the system to actually create like real communication, not just some faking some communication like yeah. But yeah, I don't think that any of those systems are trained in a in the proper way that would ensure. So that's my guess.
Right. Yes. Okay.
I think you have to wait, or you have to do your own research. It's very expensive research, though.
Christian, do you think there's a potential where pre-training on these formal verification tasks and then fine-tuning on language, on like natural language, could actually improve the sort of comprehension and
yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Yeah, that's my goal, actually. I want to create a system that is rooted in actually mathematics, that has a grounding and communicates in natural language about it. So I think you can only get to natural language understanding, real understanding, if you train in the proper way. And the proper way is, to me, is that it has to have a, I mean, that the model has to both not just see the language as an object, because, I mean, the language shouldn't be the object. The language is just a communication medium. The object, for example, is mathematics, and that's a verifiable environment in which you can create objects and manipulate those objects, and then you can talk about those objects that you did. So I think it's much likely that your system will have a real understanding if it sees the actual objects that you are talking about. Yeah.
So we have a new, what we'll have a new neural network game where you get formal language in, and then you have to communicate it in natural language to another network, which has to decode it back to the formal language and verify it. And yeah, maybe that will like force this natural language part to be correct.
Yeah. Exactly. I think that's, yeah, so that's one thing we definitely want to do. Yeah.
Cool. we have a few minutes. Samir, did you have a hand up for your question?
Oh, I can do. Yeah. I mean, really, it was, thank you. It was just a follow on, really, because the, and maybe the paper that you flashed up in the middle was doing a bit of this, but obviously there's a number of things that are trying to combine classical knowledge graphs, you know, with tuples of facts, with more modern models. And I just wondered what you thought of that as a strategy of sort of taking a knowledge graph and then binding it to something else, or is that just the same mistake as you know, the linguists made ages ago? Okay, we'll have a phoneme model, and then we'll have another model, and actually end-to-end was just better.
I don't believe in knowledge graphs too much, but yeah, I think it kind of sounds like a bit old school AI. But yeah, I think it's important to have kind of a grounding. But I think neural networks can go up with more unstructured databases. And it's important to ground things in database. So for example, there is this paper where they showed that the retrieval augmented language models are more robust, so they do less of this hallucination and stuff that was mentioned. So yes, I think that's definitely one part of the strategy to ground your knowledge in some database of facts. But I don't know whether knowledge graph. I just don't like the knowledge graph thing, because knowledge graph tend to be always very, you try to encode things about the world in a way that the basically the notions don't really, I mean, fit into the normal logic of things. So I'm very skeptical. That's it. Maybe you can make good knowledge graphs, but I think that there are too many problems in knowledge graphs in the way that people construct them.
Great, thank you so much, Christian and Max, as well, for a really great discussion. Thanks to the audience for the great questions. So the conversation and the talk has been filmed, and we'll be uploading the video to our YouTube channel. So if you just subscribe to our YouTube channel, you just go into YouTube and it's London Machine Learning Meetup. I'll also tweet about it if you connect with me at Martin Goodson on Twitter. Thanks once again to Christian and to Max. And see you next time. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye.